Clarence. By Bret Harte. Podcast 6 of 6. Part 3. Chapter 1. It was sunset of a hot day at Washington. Even at that hour the broad avenues, which diverged from the Capitol like the rays of another sun, were fierce and glittering. The sterile distances between glowed more cruelly than ever, and pedestrians, keeping in the scant shade, hesitated on the curbstones before plunging into the Sahara-like waste of crossings. The city seemed deserted. Even that vast army of contractors, speculators, place hunters, and lobbyists, which hung on the heels of the other army, and had turned this Pacific camp of the nation into a battlefield of ignoble conflict and contention more disastrous than the one to the south, had slunk into their holes in hotel back bedrooms, in shady barrooms, or in the Negro quarters of Georgetown, as if the majestic, white-robed goddess enthroned upon the dome of the Capitol had at last descended among them and was smiting to right and left with the flat and flash of her insufferable sword. Into this stifling atmosphere of greed and corruption Clarence Brandt stepped from the shadow of the War Department. For the last 3 weeks he had haunted its anterooms and audience chambers, in the vain hope of righting himself before his superiors, who were content, without formulating charges against him, to keep him in this disgrace of inaction and the anxiety of suspense. Unable to ascertain the details of the accusation, and conscious of his own secret, he was debarred the last resort of demanding a court-martial, which he knew could only exonerate him by the exposure of the guilt of his wife, whom he still hoped had safely escaped. His division commander, in active operations in the field, had no time to help him at Washington. Elbowed aside by greedy contractors, forestalled by selfish politicians, and disdaining the ordinary method of influence, he had no friend to turn to. In his few years of campaigning he had lost his instinct of diplomacy, without acquiring a soldier's bluntness. The nearly level rays of the sun forced him at last to turn aside into one of the openings of a large building, a famous caravansary of that hotel-haunted capital, and he presently found himself in the luxurious bar room, fragrant with mint, and cool with ice slabs piled symmetrically on its marble counters. A few groups of men were seeking coolness at small tables with glasses before them and palm leaf fans in their hands, but a larger and noisier assemblage was collected before the bar, where a man, collarless and in his shirt sleeves, with his back to the counter, was pretentiously addressing them. Brandt, who had moodily dropped into a chair in the corner, after ordering a cooling drink as an excuse for his temporary refuge from the stifling street, half regretted his enforced participation in their conviviality. But a sudden lowering of the speaker's voice into a note of gloomy significance seemed familiar to him. He glanced at him quickly, from the shadow of his corner. He was not mistaken, it was Jim Hooker. For the first time in his life, Brandt wished to evade him. In the days of his own prosperity his heart had always gone out towards this old companion of his boyhood. In his present humiliation his presence jarred upon him. He would have slipped away, but to do so he would have had to pass before the counter again, and Hooker, with the self-consciousness of a storyteller, had an eye on his audience. Brandt, with a palm leaf fan before his face, was obliged to listen. "Yes, gentlemen," said Hooker, examining his glass dramatically, "when a man's been cooped up in a rebel prison, with a death line before him that he's obliged to cross every time he wants a square drink, it seems sort of like a dream of his boyhood to be standin' here comfortably before his liquor, alongside o' white men once more. And when he knows he's been put to all that trouble just to save the reputation of another man, and the secrets of a few high and mighty ones, it's almost enough to make his liquor go age in him." He stopped theatrically, seemed to choke emotionally over his brandy squash, but with a pause of dramatic determination finally dashed it down. "No, gentlemen," he continued gloomily, "I don't say what I'm back in Washington for. I don't say what I've been saying to myself when I've been picking the weevils outer my biscuits in Libby prison, but if you don't see some pretty big men in the War Department obliged to climb down in the next few days, my name ain't Jim Hooker, of Hooker, Meacham and Company, Army Beef Contractors, and the man who saved the fight at Gray Oaks. The smile of satisfaction that went around his audience, an audience quick to seize the weakness of any performance, might have startled a vanity less oblivious than Hooker's, but it only aroused Brandt's indignation and pity, and made his position still more intolerable. But Hooker, scornfully expectorating a thin stream of tobacco juice against the spittoon, remained for an instant gloomily silent. "Tell us about the fight again," said a smiling auditor. Hooker looked around the room with a certain dark suspiciousness, and then, in an affected lower voice, which his theatrical experience made perfectly audible, went on. "It ain't much to speak of, and if it wasn't for the principle of the thing, I wouldn't be talking. A man who's seen in gin fightin' don't go much on this here West Point fightin' by rule of three, but that ain't here or there. Well, I'd been out a scoutin' just to help the boys along, and I was sittin' in my wagon about daybreak, when along comes a brigadier general, and he looks into the wagon flap. I oughter to tell you first, gentlemen, that every minute he was expecting an attack, but he didn't let on a hint of it to me. How are you, Jim?" said he. "How are you, General?" said I. "Would you mind lendin' me your coat and hat?" says he. "I've got a little game here with our pickets, and I don't want to be recognized." "Anything to oblige, General," said I, and with that I strips off my coat and hat, and he peels and puts them on. "Nearly the same figure, Jim," he says, looking at me, "suppose you try on my things and see." With that he hands me his coat full uniform, by GD, with the little gold cords and laces and the epaulets with a star, and I puts it on quite innocent like. And then he says, "Handin' me his sword and belt, same inches round the waist, I reckon," and I puts that on too. "You may as well keep 'em on till I come back," says he, "for it's mighty damp and malarious at this time around the swamp." And with that he lights out. Well, gentlemen, I hadn't sat there 5 minutes before bang. Bang. Rattle. Rattle. Kershise. And I hears a yell. I steps out of the wagon, everything's quite dark, but the rattle goes on. Then along trots an orderly, leading a horse. "Mount, General," he says, "we're attacked, the rear guard's on us." He paused, looked round his audience, and then in a lower voice, said darkly, "I ain't a fool, and in that minute a man's brain works at high pressure, and I saw it all. I saw the little game of the brigadier to skunk away in my clothes and leave me to be captured in his. But I ain't a dog neither, and I mounted that horse, gentlemen, and lit out to where the men were foremen. I didn't dare to speak, lest they should know me, but I waved my sword, and by GD, they followed me. And the next minute we was in the thick of it. I had my hat as full of holes as that ice strainer, I had a dozen bullets through my coat, the fringe of my epaulets was shot away, but I kept the boys at their work and we stopped 'em. Stopped 'em, gentlemen, until we heard the bugles of the rest of our division, that all this time had been rolling that blasted rear guard over on us. And it saved the fight, but the next minute the Johnny Rebs made a last dash and cut me off, and there I was by GD, a prisoner. Me that had saved the fight." A ripple of iron eichel applause went round as Hooker gloomily drained his glass, and then held up his hand in scornful deprecation. "I said I was a prisoner, gentlemen," he went on bitterly, "but that ain't all. I asked to see Johnston, told him what I had done, and demanded to be exchanged for a general officer. He said, 'You be DD.' I then sent word to the division commander-in-chief, and told him how I had saved Grey Oaks when his brigadier ran away, and he said, 'You be DD.' I've been you be DD from the lowest non-com to the commander-in-chief, and when I was at last exchanged, I was exchanged, gentlemen, for two mules and a broken wagon. But I'm here, gentlemen, as I was there. Why don't you see the president about it?" asked a bystander, in affected commiseration. Mr. Hooker stared contemptuously at the suggestion, and expectorated his scornful dissent. "Not much," he said. "But I'm going to see the man that carries him and his cabinet in his breeches pocket, Senator Boompointer. Boompointer's a big man, continued his auditor doubtfully. Do you know him?
Know him?
Mr. Hooker laughed a bitter, sardonic laugh. Well, gentlemen, I ain't the kind o' man to go in for family influence, but, he added, with gloomy elevation, considering he's an intimate relation of mine, by marriage, I should say I did. Brandt heard no more. The facing around of his old companion towards the bar gave him that opportunity of escaping he had been waiting for. The defection of Hooker and his peculiar inventions were too characteristic of him to excite surprise, and, although they no longer awakened his good-humored tolerance, they were powerless to affect him in his greater trouble. Only one thing he learned, that Hooker knew nothing of his wife being in camp as a spy. The incident would have been too tempting to have escaped his dramatic embellishment. And the allusion to Senator Boompointer, monstrous as it seemed in Hooker's mouth, gave him a grim temptation. He had heard of Boompointer's wonderful power. He believed that Susie would and could help him, Clarence, whether she did or did not help Hooker. But the next moment he dismissed the idea, with a flushing cheek. How low had he already sunk, even to think of it? It had been once or twice in his mind to seek the president, and, under a promise of secrecy, reveal a part of his story. He had heard many anecdotes of his goodness of heart and generous tolerance of all things, but with this was joined so said contemporaneous history of flippancy of speech and a brutality of directness from which Clarence's sensibility shrank. Would he see anything in his wife but a common spy on his army? Would he see anything in him but the weak victim, like many others, of a scheming woman? Stories current in camp and Congress of the way that this grim humorist had, with an apposite anecdote or a rugged illustration, brushed away the most delicate sentiment or the subtlest poetry, even as he had exposed the sham of puritanic morality or of Epicurean ethics. Brandt had even solicited an audience, but had retired awkwardly, and with his confidence unspoken, before the dark, humorous eyes, that seemed almost too tolerant of his grievance. He had been to levees, and his heart had sunk equally before the vulgar crowd, who seemed to regard this man as their own buffoon, and the pompousness of position, learning and dignity, which he seemed to delight to shake and disturb. One afternoon, a few days later, in sheer listlessness of purpose, he found himself again at the White House. The president was giving audience to a deputation of fanatics, who, with a pathetic simplicity almost equal to his own pathetic tolerance, were urging upon this ruler of millions the policy of an insignificant score, and Brandt listened to his patient, practical response of facts and logic, clothed in simple but sinewy English, up to the inevitable climax of humorous illustration, which the young brigadier could now see was necessary to relieve the grimness of his refusal. For the first time Brandt felt the courage to address him, and resolved to wait until the deputation retired. As they left the gallery he lingered in the anteroom for the president to appear. But, as he did not come, afraid of losing his chances, he returned to the gallery. Alone in his privacy and shadow, the man he had just left was standing by a column, in motionless abstraction, looking over the distant garden. But the kindly, humorous face was almost tragic with an intensity of weariness. Every line of those strong, rustic features was relaxed under a burden which even the long, lank, angular figure overgrown and unfinished as his own West seemed to be distorted in its efforts to adjust itself to, while the dark, deep-set eyes were abstracted with the vague prescience of the prophet and the martyr. Shocked at that sudden change, Brandt felt his cheek burn with shame. And he was about to break upon that wearied man's unbending, he was about to add his petty burden to the shoulders of this Western Atlas. He drew back silently, and descended the stairs. But before he had left the house, while mingling with the crowd in one of the larger rooms, he saw the president reappear beside an important, prosperous-looking figure, on whom the kindly giant was now smiling with humorous toleration. He noticed the divided attention of the crowd. The name of Senator Boompointer was upon every lip. He was nearly face to face with that famous dispenser of place and preferment, this second husband of Susie. An indescribable feeling, half cynical, half fateful, came over him. He would not have been surprised to see Jim Hooker join the throng, which now seemed to him to even dwarf the lonely central figure that had so lately touched him. He wanted to escape it all. But his fate brought him to the entrance at the same moment that Boom Pointer was leaving it, and that distinguished man brushed hastily by him as a gorgeous carriage, drawn by two spirited horses, and driven by a resplendent Negro coachman, dashed up. It was the Boom Pointer carriage. A fashionably dressed, pretty woman, who, in style, bearing, opulent contentment, and ingenuous self-consciousness, was in perfect keeping with the slight ostentation of the equipage, was its only occupant. As Boom Pointer stepped into the vehicle, her blue eyes fell for an instant on Brandt. A happy, childlike pink flush came into her cheeks, and a violet ray of recognition and mischief darted from her eyes to his. For it was Susie. Chapter 2. When Brandt returned to his hotel, there was an augmented respect in the voice of the clerk as he handed him a note with the remark that it had been left by Senator Bumpwander's coachman. He had no difficulty in recognizing Susie's peculiarly Brobdingnagian schoolgirl hand. Klaus, I call it real mean. I believe you just hoped I wouldn't know you. If you're a bit like your old self, you'll come right off here this very night. I've got a big party on, but we can talk somewhere between the acts. Haven't I growed? Tell me. And my. What a gloomy swell the young brigadier is. The carriage will come for you, so you have no excuse. The effect of this childish note upon Brandt was strangely out of proportion to its triviality. But then it was Susie's very triviality, so expressive of her characteristic irresponsibility, which had always affected him at such moments. Again, as at Robles, he felt it react against his own ethics. Was she not right in her delightful materialism? Was she not happier than if she had been consistently true to Mrs. Peyton, to the convent, to the episode of her theatrical career, to Jim Hooker, even to himself? And did he conscientiously believe that Hooker or himself had suffered from her inconsistency? No. From all that he had heard, she was a suitable helpmate to the senator, in her social attractiveness, her charming ostentations, her engaging vanity that disarmed suspicion, and her lack of responsibility even in her partisanship. Nobody ever dared to hold the senator responsible for her promises, even while enjoying the fellowship of both, and it is said that the worthy man singularly profited by it. Looking upon the invitation as a possible distraction to his gloomy thoughts, Brandt resolved to go. The moon was high as the carriage whirled him out of the still stifling avenues towards the Soldiers' Home, a sylvan suburb frequented by cabinet ministers and the president, where the good senator had decreed, like Kublai Khan, a stately pleasure dome, to entertain his friends and partisans. As they approached the house, the trembling light like fireflies through the leaves, the warm silence broken only by a military band playing a drowsy waltz on the veranda, and the heavy odors of jessamine in the air, thrilled Brandt with a sense of shame as he thought of his old comrades in the field. But this was presently dissipated by the uniforms that met him in the hall, with the presence of some of his distinguished superiors. At the head of the stairs, with a circling background of the shining crosses and ribbons of the diplomatic corps, stood Susie, her bare arms and neck glittering with diamonds, her face radiant with childlike vivacity. A significant pressure of her little glove as he made his bow seemed to be his only welcome, but a moment later she caught his arm. "You've yet to know him," she said in a half whisper, "he thinks a good deal of himself, just like Jim. But he makes others believe it, and that's where poor Jim slipped up." She paused before the man thus characteristically disposed of, and presented Brandt. It was the man he had seen before, material, capable, dogmatic. A glance from his shrewd eyes, accustomed to the weighing of men's weaknesses and ambitions, and a few hurried phrases, apparently satisfied him that Brandt was not just then important or available to him, and the two men, a moment later, drifted easily apart. Brandt sauntered listlessly through the crowded rooms, half remorsefully conscious that he had taken some irrevocable step, and none the less assured by the presence of two or three reporters and correspondents who were dogging his steps, or the glance of two or three pretty women whose curiosity had evidently been aroused by the singular abstraction of this handsome, distinguished, but sardonic-looking officer. but the next moment he was genuinely moved. A tall young woman had just glided into the center of the room with an indolent yet supple gracefulness that seemed familiar to him. A change in her position suddenly revealed her face. It was Miss Faulkner. Previously he had known her only in the riding habit of Confederate gray which she had at first affected, or in the light muslin morning dress she had worn at Gray Oaks. It seemed to him, tonight, that the studied elegance of her full dress became her still more, that the pretty willfulness of her chin and shoulders was chastened and modified by the pearls round her fair throat. Suddenly their eyes met, her face paled visibly, he fancied that she almost leaned against her companion for support, then she met his glance again with a face into which the color had as suddenly rushed, but with eyes that seemed to be appealing to him even to the point of pain and fright. Brandt was not conceited, he could see that the girl's agitation was not the effect of any mere personal influence in his recognition, but of something else. He turned hastily away, when he looked around again she was gone. Nevertheless he felt filled with a vague irritation. Did she think him such a fool as to imperil her safety by openly recognizing her without her consent? Did she think that he would dare to presume upon the service she had done him? Or, more outrageous thought, had she heard of his disgrace, known its cause, and feared that he would drag her into a disclosure to save himself? No, no, she could not think that. She had perhaps regretted what she had done in a freak of girlish chivalry, she had returned to her old feelings and partisanship, she was only startled at meeting the single witness of her folly. Well, she need not fear. He would as studiously avoid her hereafter, and she should know it. And yet yes, there was a yet. For he could not forget indeed, in the past 3 weeks it had been more often before him than he cared to think that she was the one human being who had been capable of a great act of self-sacrifice for him, her enemy, her accuser, the man who had scarcely treated her civilly. He was ashamed to remember now that this thought had occurred to him at the bedside of his wife at the hour of her escape even on the fatal slope on which he had been struck down. And now this fond illusion must go with the rest. The girl who had served him so loyally was ashamed of it. A bitter smile crossed his face. Well, I don't wonder. Here are all the women asking me who is that good-looking Mephistopheles, with the burning eyes, who is prowling around my rooms as if searching for a victim. Why, you're smiling for all the world like poor Jim when he used to do the Red Avenger. Susie's voice and illustration recalled him to himself. Furious I may be, he said with a gentler smile, although his eyes still glittered, furious that I have to wait until the one woman I came to see, the one woman I have not seen for so long, while these puppets have been nightly dancing before her, can give me a few moments from them, to talk of the old days. In his reaction he was quite sincere, although he felt a slight sense of remorse as he saw the quick, faint color rise, as in those old days, even through the tonight's powder of her cheek. That's like the old Klaunus, she said, with a slight pressure of his arm, but we will not have a chance to speak until later. When they are nearly all gone, you'll take me to get a little refreshment, and we'll have a chat in the conservatory. But you must drop that awfully wicked look and make yourself generally agreeable to those women until then. It was, perhaps, part of this reaction which enabled him to obey his hostess' commands with a certain recklessness that, however, seemed to be in keeping with the previous satanic reputation he had all unconsciously achieved. The women listened to the cynical flippancy of this good-looking soldier with an undisguised admiration which in turn excited curiosity and envy from his own sex. He saw the whispered questioning, the lifted eyebrows, scornful shrugging of shoulders and knew that the story of his disgrace was in the air. But I fear this only excited him to further recklessness and triumph. Once he thought he recognized Miss Faulkner's figure at a distance, and even fancied that she had been watching him, but he only redoubled his attentions to the fair woman beside him, and looked no more. Yet he was glad when the guests began to drop off, the great rooms thinned, and Susie, appearing on the arm of her husband, coquettishly reminded him of his promise. "For I want to talk to you of old times. General Brandt," she went on, turning explanatorily to Boompointer, "married my adopted mother in California at Robles, a dear old place where I spent my earliest years. So, you see, we are sort of relations by marriage," she added, with delightful naivete. Hooker's own vainglorious allusion to his relations to the men before him flashed across Brandt's mind, but it left now only a smile on his lips. He felt he had already become a part of the irresponsible comedy played around him. Why should he resist, or examine its ethics too closely? He offered his arm to Susie as they descended the stairs, but, instead of pausing in the supper room, she simply passed through it with a significant pressure on his arm, and, drawing aside a muslin curtain, stepped into the moonlit conservatory. Behind the curtain there was a small rustic settee. Without releasing his arm she sat down, so that when he dropped beside her, their hands met, and mutually clasped. "Now, Clarence," she said, with a slight, comfortable shiver as she nestled beside him, "it's a little like your chair down at Old Robles, isn't it? Tell me. And to think it's 5 years ago. But, Clarence, what's the matter?" "You are changed," she said, looking at his dark face in the moonlight, "or you have something to tell me."
"I have.
And it's something dreadful, I know," she said, wrinkling her brows with a pretty terror. "Couldn't you pretend you had told it to me, and let us go on just the same? Couldn't you, Clarence?
Tell me."
"I am afraid I couldn't," he said, with a sad smile. "Is it about yourself, Clarence?"
"You know," she went on with cheerful rapidity, "I know everything about you. I always did, you know, and I don't care, and never did care, and it don't, and never did, make the slightest difference to me. So don't tell it, and waste time, Clarence.
It's not about me, but about my wife," he said slowly. Her expression changed slightly.
"Oh, her," she said after a pause.
Then, half resignedly, "go on, Clarence. He began. He had a dozen times rehearsed to himself his miserable story, always feeling it keenly, and even fearing that he might be carried away by emotion or morbid sentiment in telling it to another. But, to his astonishment, he found himself telling it practically, calmly, almost cynically, to his old playmate, repressing the half-devotion and even tenderness that had governed him, from the time that his wife, disguised as the mulatto woman, had secretly watched him at his office, to the hour that he had passed through the lines. He withheld only the incident of Miss Faulkner's complicity and sacrifice. "And she got away, after having kicked you out of your place, Clarence," said Susie, when he had ended. Clarence stiffened beside her. But he felt he had gone too far to quarrel with his confidant. "She went away. I honestly believe we shall never meet again, or I should not be telling you this. Clarence," she said lightly, taking his hand again, "don't you believe it? She won't let you go. You're one of those men that a woman, when she's once hooked onto, won't let go of, even when she believes she no longer loves him, or meets bigger and better men. I reckon it's because you're so different from other men. Maybe there are so many different things about you to hook onto, and you don't slip off as easily as the others. Now, if you were like old Peyton, her first husband, or like poor Jim, or even my boom pointer, you'd be all right. No, my boy, all we can do is to try to keep her from getting at you here. I reckon she won't trust herself in Washington again in a hurry. But I cannot stay here, my career is in the field. Your career is alongside Omi, honey and boom pointer. But nearer me. We'll fix all that. I heard something about your being in disgrace, but the story was that you were sweet on some secesh girl down there, and neglected your business, Clarence. But, lordy. To think it was only your own wife. Never mind, we'll straighten that out. We've had worse jobs than that on. Why? There was that commissary who was buying up dead horses at one end of the field, and selling them to the government for mess beef at the other, and there was that general who wouldn't make an attack when it rained, and the other general, you know who I mean,
Clarence, who wouldn't invade the state where his sister lived, but we straightened them out, somehow, and they were a heap worse than you. We'll get you a position in the War Department here, one of the bureau offices, where you keep your rank and your uniform. You don't look bad in it, Clarence, on better pay. And you'll come and see me, and we'll talk over old times. Brant felt his heart turn sick within him. But he was at her mercy now. He said, with an effort. But I've told you that my career, nay, my life now is in the field. Don't you be a fool, Clarence, and leave it there. You have done your work of fighting mighty good fighting, too, and everybody knows it. You've earned a change. Let others take your place. He shuddered, as he remembered that his wife had made the same appeal. Was he a fool then, and these two women so totally unlike in everything right in this? Come, Clarence, said Susie, relapsing again against his shoulder. Now talk to me. You don't say what you think of me, of my home, of my furniture, of my position, even of him. Tell me. I find you well, prosperous, and happy, he said, with a faint smile. Is that all? And how do I look? She turned her still youthful, mischievous face towards him in the moonlight. The witchery of her blue eyes was still there as of old, the same frank irresponsibility beamed from them, her parted lips seemed to give him back the breath of his youth. He started, but she did not. Susie, dear. It was her husband's voice. I quite forgot, the senator went on, as he drew the curtain aside, that you are engaged with a friend, but Miss Faulkner is waiting to say good night, and I volunteered to find you. Tell her to wait a moment, said Susie, with an impatience that was as undisguised as it was without embarrassment or confusion. But Miss Faulkner, unconsciously following Mr. Boompointer, was already upon them. For a moment the whole four were silent, although perfectly composed. Senator Boompointer, unconscious of any infelicity in his interruption, was calmly waiting. Clarence, opposed suddenly to the young girl whom he believed was avoiding his recognition, rose, coldly imperturbable. Miss Faulkner, looking taller and more erect in the long folds of her satin cloak, neither paled nor blushed, as she regarded Susie and Brant with a smile of well-bred apology. I expect to leave Washington tomorrow, and may not be able to call again, she said, or I would not have so particularly pressed a leave-taking upon you. I was talking with my old friend, General Brant, said Susie, more by way of introduction than apology. Brant bowed. For an instant the clear eyes of Miss Faulkner slipped icily across his as she made him an old-fashioned southern courtesy, and, taking Susie's arm, she left the room. Brant did not linger, but took leave of his host almost in the same breath. At the front door a well-appointed carriage of one of the legationes had just rolled into waiting. He looked back, he saw Miss Faulkner, erect and looking like a bride in her gauzy draperies, descending the stairs before the waiting servants. He felt his heart beat strangely. He hesitated, recalled himself with an effort, hurriedly stepped from the porch into the path, as he heard the carriage door close behind him in the distance, and then felt the dust from her horse's hoofs rise around him as she drove past him and away. Chapter 3. Although Brant was convinced as soon as he left the house that he could not accept anything from the Boompointer influence, and that his interview with Susie was fruitless, he knew that he must temporize. While he did not believe that his old playmate would willingly betray him, he was uneasy when he thought of the vanity and impulsiveness which might compromise him or of a possible jealousy that might seek revenge. Yet he had no reason to believe that Susie's nature was jealous, or that she was likely to have any cause, but the fact remained that Miss Faulkner's innocent intrusion upon their tete-a-tete affected him more strongly than anything else in his interview with Susie. Once out of the atmosphere of that house, it struck him, too, that Miss Faulkner was almost as much of an alien in it as himself. He wondered what she had been doing there. Could it be possible that she was obtaining information for the South? But he rejected the idea as quickly as it had occurred to him. Perhaps there could be no stronger proof of the unconscious influence the young girl already had over him. He remembered the liveries of the diplomatic carriage that had borne her away, and ascertained without difficulty that her sister had married one of the foreign ministers, and that she was a guest in his house. But he was the more astonished to hear that she and her sister were considered to be Southern Unionists and were greatly petted in governmental circles for their sacrificing fidelity to the flag. His informant, an official in the State Department, added that Miss Matilda might have been a good deal of a madcap at the outbreak of the war, for the sisters had a brother in the Confederate service, but that she had changed greatly, and, indeed, within a month. For, he added, she was at the White House for the first time last week, and they say the President talked more to her than to any other woman. The indescribable sensation with which this simple information filled Brandt startled him more than the news itself. Hope, joy, fear, distrust, and despair, alternately distracted him. He recalled Miss Faulkner's almost agonizing glance of appeal to him in the drawing room at Susie's, and it seemed to be equally consistent with the truth of what he had just heard, or some monstrous treachery and deceit of which she might be capable. Even now she might be a secret emissary of some spy within the President's family, she might have been in correspondence with some traitor in the Boompointer clique, and her imploring glance only the result of a fear of exposure. Or, again, she might have truly recanted after her escapade at Grey Oaks, and feared only his recollection of her as go-between of spies. And yet both of these presumptions were inconsistent with her conduct in the conservatory. It seemed impossible that this impulsive woman, capable of doing what he had himself known her to do, and equally sensitive to the shame or joy of such impulses, should be the same conventional woman of society who had so coldly recognized and parted from him. But this interval of doubt was transitory. The next day he received a dispatch from the War Department, ordering him to report himself for duty at once. With a beating heart he hurried to the secretary. But that official had merely left a memorandum with his assistant directing General Brandt to accompany some fresh levies to a camp of organization near the front. Brandt felt a chill of disappointment. Duties of this kind had been left to dubious regular army veterans, hurriedly displaced general officers, and favored detrimentals. But if it was not restoration, it was no longer inaction, and it was at least a release from Washington. It was also evidently the result of some influence, but hardly that of the Boompointers, for he knew that Susie wished to keep him at the Capitol. Was there another power at work to send him away from Washington? His previous doubts returned. Nor were they dissipated when the chief of the bureau placed a letter before him with the remark that it had been entrusted to him by a lady with the request that it should be delivered only into his own hands. She did not know your hotel address, but ascertained you were to call here. She said it was of some importance. There is no mystery about it, General, continued the official with a mischievous glance at Brandt's handsome, perplexed face, although it's from a very pretty woman whom we all know. Mrs. Boompointer, suggested Brandt, with affected lightness. It was a maladroit speech. The official's face darkened. We have not yet become a postal department for the Boompointers, General, he said dryly, however great their influence elsewhere. It was from rather a different style of woman, Miss Faulkner. You will receive your papers later at your hotel, and leave tonight. Brandt's unlucky slip was still potent enough to divert the official attention, or he would have noticed the change in his visitor's face, and the abruptness of his departure. Once in the street, Brandt tore off the envelope. But beneath it was another, on which was written in a delicate, refined hand, "Please do not open this until you reach your destination." Then she knew he was going. And perhaps this was her influence. All his suspicions again returned. She knew he was going near the lines, and his very appointment, through her power, might be a plot to serve her and the enemy. Was this letter, which she was entrusting to him, the cover of some missive to her Southern friends which she expected him to carry, perhaps as a return for her own act of self-sacrifice? Was this the appeal she had been making to his chivalry, his gratitude, his honor? The perspiration stood in beads on his forehead. What defect lay hidden in his nature that seemed to make him an easy victim of these intriguing women? He had not even the excuse of gallantry, less susceptible to the potencies of the sex than most men, he was still compelled to bear that reputation. He remembered his coldness to Miss Faulkner in the first days of their meeting, and her effect upon his subalterns. Why had she selected him from among them when she could have modeled the others like wax to her purposes? Why? And yet with the question came a possible answer that he hardly dared to think of, that in its very vagueness seemed to fill him with a stimulating thrill and hopefulness. He quickened his pace. He would take the letter, and yet be master of himself when the time came to open it. That time came 3 days later, in his tent at Three Pines Crossing. As he broke open the envelope, he was relieved to find that it contained no other enclosure, and seemed intended only for himself. It began abruptly. "When you read this, you will understand why I did not speak to you when we met last night, why I even dreaded that you might speak to me, knowing, as I did, what I ought to tell you at that place and moment, something you could only know from me. I did not know you were in Washington, although I knew you were relieved. I had no way of seeing you or sending to you before, and I only came to Mrs. Bumpwanter's party in the hope of hearing news of you. You know that my brother was captured by your pickets in company with another officer. He thinks you suspected the truth that he and his friend were hovering near your lines to effect the escape of the spy. But he says that, although they failed to help her, she did escape, or was passed through the lines by your connivance. He says that you seemed to know her, that from what Rose the mulatto woman told him, you and she were evidently old friends. I would not speak of this, nor intrude upon your private affairs, only that I think you ought to know that I had no knowledge of it when I was in your house, but believed her to be a stranger to you. You gave me no intimation that you knew her, and I believed that you were frank with me. But I should not speak of this at all, for I believe that it would have made no difference to me in repairing the wrong that I thought I had done you, only that, as I am forced by circumstances to tell you the terrible ending of this story, you ought to know it all. My brother wrote to me that the evening after you left, the burying party picked up the body of what they believed to be a mulatto woman lying on the slope. It was not Rose, but the body of the very woman, the real and only spy whom you had passed through the lines. She was accidentally killed by the Confederates in the first attack upon you, at daybreak. But only my brother and his friend recognized her through her blackened face and disguise, and on the plea that she was a servant of one of their friends, they got permission from the division commander to take her away, and she was buried by her friends and among her people in the little cemetery of Three Pines Crossing, not far from where you have gone. My brother thought that I ought to tell you this. It seems that he and his friend had a strange sympathy for you in what they appear to know or guess of your relations with that woman, and I think he was touched by what he thought was your kindness and chivalry to him on account of his sister. But I do not think he ever knew, or will know, how great is the task that he has imposed upon me. You know now, do you not, why I did not speak to you when we first met? It seemed so impossible to do it in an atmosphere and a festivity that was so incongruous with the dreadful message I was charged with. And when I had to meet you later, perhaps I may have wronged you, but it seemed to me that you were so preoccupied and interested with other things that I might perhaps only be wearying you with something you cared little for, or perhaps already knew and had quickly forgotten. I had been wanting to say something else to you when I had got rid of my dreadful message. I do not know if you still care to hear it. But you were once generous enough to think that I had done you a service in bringing a letter to your commander. Although I know better than anybody else the genuine devotion to your duty that made you accept my poor service, from all that I can hear, you have never had the credit of it. Will you not try me again? I am more in favor here, and I might yet be more successful in showing your superiors how true you have been to your trust, even if you have little faith in your friend, Matilda Faulkner. For a long time he remained motionless, with the letter in his hand. Then he arose, ordered his horse, and galloped away. There was little difficulty in finding the cemetery of Three Pines Crossing, a hillside slope, pierced with pine and cypress, and starred with white crosses, that in the distance looked like flowers. Still less was there in finding the newer marble shaft among the older lichen-spotted slabs, which bore the simple words, Alice Benham, Martyr. A few Confederate soldiers, under still plainer and newer wooden headstones, carved only with initials, lay at her feet. Brant sank on his knees beside the grave, but he was shocked to see that the base of the marble was stained with the red pollen of the fateful lily, whose blossoms had been heaped upon her mound, but whose fallen petals lay dark and sodden in decay. How long he remained there he did not know. And then a solitary bugle from the camp seemed to summon him, as it had once before summoned him, and he went away as he had gone before to a separation that he now knew was for all time. Then followed a month of superintendence and drill, and the infusing into the little camp under his instruction the spirit which seemed to be passing out of his own life forever. Shut in by alien hills on the borderland of the great struggle, from time to time reports reached him of the bitter fighting, and almost disastrous successes of his old division commander. Orders came from Washington to hurry the preparation of his raw levies to the field, and a faint hope sprang up in his mind. But following it came another dispatch ordering his return to the capital. He reached it with neither hope nor fear, so benumbed had become his spirit under this last trial, and what seemed to be now the mockery of this last sacrifice to his wife. Though it was no longer a question of her life and safety, he knew that he could still preserve her memory from stain by keeping her secret, even though its divulgings might clear his own. For that reason, he had even hesitated to inform Susie of her death, in the fear that, in her thoughtless irresponsibility and impulsiveness, she might be tempted to use it in his favor. He had made his late appointment a plea for her withholding any present efforts to assist him. He even avoided the Bumpwander's house, in what he believed was partly a duty to the memory of his wife. But he saw no inconsistency in occasionally extending his lonely walks to the vicinity of a foreign legation, or in being lifted with a certain expectation at the sight of its liveries on the avenue. There was a craving for sympathy in his heart, which Miss Faulkner's letter had awakened. Meantime, he had reported himself for duty at the War Department with little hope, however, in that formality. But he was surprised the next day when the chief of the bureau informed him that his claim was before the president. "I was not aware that I had presented any claim," he said, a little haughtily. The bureau chief looked up with some surprise. This quiet, patient, reserved man had puzzled him once or twice before. "Perhaps I should say case, general," he said, drily. "But the personal interest of the highest executive in the land strikes me as being desirable in anything. I only mean that I have obeyed the orders of the department in reporting myself here, as I have done," said Brant, with less feeling, but none the less firmness, "and I should imagine it was not the duty of a soldier to question them. Which I fancy a claim or a case would imply." He had no idea of taking this attitude before, but the disappointments of the past month, added to this first official notice of his disgrace, had brought forward that dogged, reckless, yet half-scornful obstinacy that was part of his nature. The official smiled. "I suppose, then, you are waiting to hear from the president," he said drily. "I am awaiting orders from the department," returned Brant quietly, "but whether they originate in the president as commander-in-chief, or not it is not for me to inquire." Even when he reached his hotel this half-savage indifference which had taken the place of his former incertitude had not changed. It seemed to him that he had reached the crisis of his life where he was no longer a free agent, and could wait, superior alike to effort or expectation. And it was with a merely dispassionate curiosity that he found a note the next morning from the president's private secretary, informing him that the president would see him early that day. A few hours later he was ushered through the public rooms of the White House to a more secluded part of the household. The messenger stopped before a modest door and knocked. It was opened by a tall figure, the president himself. He reached out a long arm to Brant, who stood hesitatingly on the threshold, grasped his hand, and led him into the room. It had a single, large, elaborately draped window and a handsome medallioned carpet, which contrasted with the otherwise almost appalling simplicity of the furniture. A single plain angular desk, with a blotting pad and a few sheets of large foolscap upon it, a waste paper basket and four plain armchairs, completed the interior with a contrast as simple and homely as its long-limbed, black-coated occupant. Releasing the hand of the general to shut a door which opened into another apartment, the president shoved an armchair towards him and sank somewhat wearily into another before the desk. But only for a moment, the long shambling limbs did not seem to adjust themselves easily to the chair, the high narrow shoulders drooped to find a more comfortable lounging attitude, shifted from side to side, and the long legs moved dispersedly. Yet the face that was turned towards Brandt was humorous and tranquil. "I was told I should have to send for you if I wished to see you," he said smilingly. Already mollified, and perhaps again falling under the previous influence of this singular man, Brandt began somewhat hesitatingly to explain. But the president checked him gently. "You don't understand. It was something new to my experience here to find an able-bodied American citizen with an honest, genuine grievance who had to have it drawn from him like a decayed tooth. But you have been here before. I seem to remember your face." Brandt's reserve had gone. He admitted that he had twice sought an audience but... "You dodged the dentist. That was wrong." As Brandt made a slight movement of deprecation, the president continued, "I understand. Not from fear of giving pain to yourself but to others. I don't know that that is right, either. A certain amount of pain must be suffered in this world even by one's enemies. Well, I have looked into your case, General Brandt." He took up a piece of paper from his desk, scrawled with two or three notes in pencil. "I think this is the way it stands. You were commanding a position at Gray Oaks when information was received by the department that, either through neglect or complicity, spies were passing through your lines. There was no attempt to prove your neglect, your orders, the facts of your personal care and precaution, were all before the department. But it was also shown that your wife, from whom you were only temporarily separated, was a notorious secessionist, that, before the war, you yourself were suspected, and that, therefore, you were quite capable of evading your own orders, which you may have only given as a blind. On this information you were relieved by the department of your command. Later on it was discovered that the spy was none other than your own wife, disguised as a mulatto, that, after her arrest by your own soldiers, you connived at her escape, and this was considered conclusive proof of, well, let us say your treachery. But I did not know it was my wife until she was arrested," said Brandt impulsively. The president knitted his eyebrows humorously. "Don't let us travel out of the record, General. You're as bad as the department. The question was one of your personal treachery, but you need not accept the fact that you were justly removed because your wife was a spy. Now, General, I am an old lawyer, and I don't mind telling you that in Illinois we wouldn't hang a yellow dog on that evidence before the department. But when I was asked to look into the matter by your friends, I discovered something of more importance to you. I had been trying to find a scrap of evidence that would justify the presumption that you had sent information to the enemy. I found that it was based upon the fact of the enemy being in possession of knowledge at the first battle at Gray Oaks, which could only have been obtained from our side, and which led to a federal disaster, that you, however, retrieved by your gallantry. I then asked the secretary if he was prepared to show that you had sent the information with that view, or that you had been overtaken by a tardy sense of repentance. He preferred to consider my suggestion as humorous. But the inquiry led to my further discovery that the only treasonable correspondence actually in evidence was found upon the body of a trusted federal officer, and had been forwarded to the division commander. But there was no record of it in the case. Why, I forwarded it myself," said Brandt eagerly. "So the division commander writes," said the president, smiling, "and he forwarded it to the department. But it was suppressed in some way. Have you any enemies, General Brandt?"
"Not that I know of."
"Then you probably have. You are young and successful. Think of the 100 other officers who naturally believe themselves better than you are, and haven't a traitorous wife. Still, the department may have made an example of you for the benefit of the only man who couldn't profit by it. Might it not have been, sir, that this suppression was for the good report of the service as the chief offender was dead? I am glad to hear you say so, General, for it is the argument I have used successfully in behalf of your wife. Then you know it all, sir, said Brandt after a gloomy pause. All, I think. Come, General, you seem just now to be uncertain about your enemies. Let me assure you, you need not be so in regard to your friends. I dare to hope I have found one, sir, said Brandt with almost boyish timidity. Oh, not me, said the president, with a laugh of deprecation. Someone much more potent. May I know his name, Mr. President? No, for it is a woman. You were nearly ruined by one, General. I suppose it's quite right that you should be saved by one. And, of course, irregularly. A woman, echoed Brandt. Yes, one who was willing to confess herself a worse spy than your wife, a double traitor, to save you. Upon my word, General, I don't know if the department was far wrong, a man with such an alternately unsettling and convincing effect upon a woman's highest political convictions should be under some restraint. Luckily the department knows nothing of it. Nor would anyone else have known from me, said Brandt eagerly. I trust that she did not think that you, sir, did not for an instant believe that I. Oh dear, no. Nobody would have believed you. It was her free confidence to me. That was what made the affair so difficult to handle. For even her bringing your dispatch to the division commander looked bad for you, and you know he even doubted its authenticity. Does Miss Faulkner know the spy was my wife? Hesitated Brandt. The president twisted himself in his chair, so as to regard Brandt more gravely with his deep-set eyes, and then thoughtfully rubbed his leg. Don't let us travel out of the record, General, he said after a pause. But as the color surged into Brandt's cheek he raised his eyes to the ceiling, and said, in half-humorous recollection. No, I think that fact was first gathered from your other friend Mr. Hooker. Hooker, said Brandt, indignantly, did he come here? Pray don't destroy my faith in Mr. Hooker, General, said the president, in half-weary, half-humorous deprecation. Don't tell me that any of his inventions are true. Leave me at least that magnificent liar the one perfectly intelligible witness you have. For from the time that he first appeared here with a grievance and a claim for a commission, he has been an unspeakable joy to me and a convincing testimony to you. Other witnesses have been partisans and prejudiced, Mr. Hooker was frankly true to himself. How else should I have known of the care you took to disguise yourself, save the honor of your uniform, and run the risk of being shot as an unknown spy at your wife's side, except from his magnificent version of his part in it? How else should I have known the story of your discovery of the Californian conspiracy, except from his supreme portrayal of it, with himself as the hero? No, you must not forget to thank Mr. Hooker when you meet him. Miss Faulkner is at present more accessible, she is calling on some members of my family in the next room. Shall I leave you with her? Brandt rose with a pale face and a quickly throbbing heart as the president, glancing at the clock, untwisted himself from the chair, and shook himself out full length, and rose gradually to his feet. Your wish for active service is granted, General Brandt, he said slowly, and you will at once rejoin your old division commander, who is now at the head of the 10th Army Corps. But, he said, after a deliberate pause, there are certain rules and regulations of your service that even I cannot, with decent respect to your department, override. You will, therefore, understand that you cannot rejoin the army in your former position. The slight flush that came to Brandt's cheek quickly passed. And there was only the unmistakable sparkle of renewed youth in his frank eyes as he said, "Let me go to the front again, Mr. President, and I care not how." The president smiled, and, laying his heavy hand on Brandt's shoulder, pushed him gently towards the door of the inner room. "I was only about to say," he added, as he opened the door, that it would be necessary for you to rejoin your promoted commander as a major general. And, he continued, lifting his voice, as he gently pushed his guest into the room, he hasn't even thanked me for it, Miss Faulkner. The door closed behind him, and he stood for a moment dazed, and still hearing the distant voice of the president, in the room he had just quitted, now welcoming a new visitor. But the room before him, opening into a conservatory, was empty, save for a single figure that turned, half timidly, half mischievously, towards him. The same quick, sympathetic glance was in both their faces, the same timid, happy look in both their eyes. He moved quickly to her side. "Then you knew that that woman was my wife," he said, hurriedly, as he grasped her hand. She cast a half-appealing look at his face, a half-frightened one around the room and at the open door beyond. "Let us," she said faintly, "go into the conservatory." *. It is but a few years ago that the voracious chronicler of these pages moved with a wondering crowd of sightseers in the gardens of the White House. The war cloud had long since lifted and vanished, the Potomac flowed peacefully by and on to where once lay the broad plantation of a great Confederate leader, now a national cemetery that had gathered the soldier dead of both sections side by side in equal rest and honor, and the great goddess once more looked down serenely from the dome of the White Capitol. The chronicler's attention was attracted by an erect, handsome, soldierly-looking man, with a beard and mustache slightly streaked with gray, pointing out the various objects of interest to a boy of 12 or 14 at his side. "Yes, although, as I told you, this house belongs only to the President of the United States and his family," said the gentleman, smilingly, "in that little conservatory I proposed to your mother." "Oh, Clarence, how can you?" said the lady, reprovingly, "you know it was long after that.